What happens in every single episode of Survivor? There have been episodes without hidden immunity idols, without twists, without voting someone out, even without tribal council. But there has never been an episode of Survivor without at least one challenge, which means we have a lot of data about challenges. Now, in the most recent season of Survivor, Survivor 42, challenges like this...
Jonathan is single-handedly determined to win this challenge for Taku!
...had people wondering if Jonathan was the best challenge competitor of all time. And I was curious, and as we know, I'm also not afraid of large sets of data and ranking things. So I decided to try and figure out, objectively and with data, who is the best challenge competitor in the history of Survivor. Now, what I'm not asking is who has won the most challenges, because that's boring. That's easy to find and it's already documented other places. What I wanted to find out is, regardless of how many they've played in, who is statistically the most dominant at Survivor challenges? Put another way, imagine that you have to bet your life on a single Survivor player winning a challenge. You don't know if it's an individual challenge, a team challenge, or what the challenge involves, but you can have one person play in it, and if they win, you live, and if they lose, you die. Who should you bet on? And on the flip side, who are the worst challenge competitors of all time? Who should you never, ever bet on to win a challenge? Before we get going, two quick disclaimers. First, and hopefully obviously, whether or not someone wins challenges has nothing to do with how good of an overall Survivor player they are. Sandra, for instance, is historically terrible at challenges and has won twice. Second, this is going to be pretty results-oriented. Some players who probably would have been really good at challenges only got to do one or two before being voted out, and so that's all the data we have on them. I tried to account for that somewhat, but just keep that in mind as we go through the rankings. So the metric I created for this video is called a WAR score, which stands for Wins Above Replacement. This is a statistic that's actually very common in Major League Baseball in order to gauge just how valuable a player is to his team's starting lineup. So I decided to apply it to Survivor. In short, the WAR score tells us how many more or less wins that a player has compared to the average player, based on how many challenges they've played. This is calculated separately for team-based challenges and individual challenges, and then added together to get the total WAR score. For example, Rafe from Guatemala competed in 25 challenges during his season, including 13 team-based challenges and 12 individual challenges. Now, we would expect an average player to win 6.1 team challenges and 1.7 individual challenges. In actuality, Rafe's teams won 4 challenges, giving him a team WAR score of negative 2.1, because he won 2 fewer challenges than you would expect. But in individual challenges, Rafe won 4, which is 2 more challenges than you would expect based on how many he played. All in all, that means Rafe has an individual WAR score of 2.92, which combines with his negative team WAR score to give him an overall WAR rating of 0.81. A WAR score of 0 corresponds to the average Survivor player. Out of everyone who's ever played Survivor, the average team win percent is 47%, and the average individual win percent is 14%. Over the course of a typical season, then, we might expect the average person to win about 5 challenges as a tribe, 1 team-based reward challenge, and 1, maybe 2, individual challenges. In fact, and I say this mostly because I know he would hate to hear this, the most average Survivor challenge competitor of all time is Coach, who has a 48% team win rate and a 12% individual win rate. He has played in 50 challenges, won 16 out of 33 team challenges, and 2 out of 17 individual challenges, and had one other near win. This all adds up to give him a weighted WAR score of 0.12. So far, so good, right? Well, that's what I was thinking when I was creating this system, and then I found a flaw. Let me walk you through 2 players. Ben is someone who has played in more than 20 individual challenges without ever winning one. Meanwhile, Spencer has played in the same number of individual challenges, but he's won 6. Most people would reasonably conclude that Spencer is a better challenge competitor than Ben. Except the formula disagreed. Ben had a higher WAR score than Spencer. Why? because Spencer was on tribes and teams that lost a lot on both of his seasons, and Ben was on tribes that won a lot. It doesn't matter that Spencer was often one of the best players on his team. The system sees the L's, and because team win counts just as much as individual wins, Ben gets graded higher. Thankfully, fixing this problem was pretty simple. Basically, I weighted the formula to make individual challenges matter twice as much as team challenges when grading someone's overall war score. I call this the weighted war score, and it's what the rankings in this video are based on. Two more things before we get started. First, I decided to also give players partial credit for near wins in individual challenges. What does a near win look like? Well,
to lock in. Ben thinks he has it. No, something is not right.
Or how about
Russell hits the post.
Oh, man.
Russell wins immunity.
Basically, near wins demonstrate that a player was competitive in the challenge down to the very last second. They were either the last player to fall before the winner, or seconds away from finishing the puzzle themselves, or literally lost consciousness before finishing the challenge. A near win is valued as equal to 1/3 of an actual win. Second, I also factored sit-outs into players' team scores, or rather, I factored them out. Basically, if a player sat out of a challenge, that challenge does not count toward their total challenges played, and the result of that challenge, whether the team won or lost, does not count toward the player's win total. A player's win percentage only accounts for the challenges that they actually participated in. Now, let's get to the rankings. The vast majority of players are, as you would expect, average. Of the 626 contestants over the first 42 seasons, 564 of them have a war score between 4 and negative 3. And if I'm being honest, it's really boring to rank these players, and there's not much to say about most of them. Don't worry, this video isn't false advertising. I did rank all of these players, and there's a Google spreadsheet with all that info in the summary if you want to see it. It's just that this video would be, I don't know, 7 hours long, and 6 hours of it would be just like painfully boring if I ranked all those people in the video, so you can check the spreadsheet for them. Suffice it to say, these are all players who are basically fine at challenges. This group includes players like Amber, Russell, Danielle, Wentworth, Aubrey, Tina, Ethan, Coach, of course, and surprisingly, Sandra. Interestingly enough, Sandra's teams tend to win a lot when she plays, which means that even though she's very bad at individual challenges, and I mean very bad, she has the lowest individual war score ever recorded, her team performances actually keep her out of the bottom tier. So once we rule out the average players, and then remove players with an insufficient sample size of challenges played, we're left with a top 40 and a bottom 17. And these players? Oh, we can rank them, though we're going to go pretty quick through some of them. Let's start with the 17 worst challenge competitors in Survivor history, based on the data. Remember, we're only counting the challenges that they actually played in, and even giving partial credit for coming close to winning. And after all that, there are still more than 600 players who were better than the people I'm about to name. These players are true outliers in terms of being bad at challenges. Number 17, Earl from Fiji, is going to shock a lot of people. He was on a bad starting tribe, and he never won an individual challenge or even came close. He's not the worst one here, but he's far from the best. Number 16 is Ken from Gabon. Full transparency, I thought Ken was going to be lower, given that his team's only won one challenge all season, but his single immunity win, plus a couple of other near wins, keeps him off the bottom. Number 15 is Lauren from The Edge of Extinction. She gives the impression that she would be good at challenges, and she had two near wins, but only won 4 out of 24 challenges that she played in all season. Number 14, Karishma from Island of the Idols. Karishma's teams won only 3 of 11 challenges, and she never won an individual challenge for herself. Number 13, Christina, and number 12, Tarzan, come from the same season, One World, so it feels only right to group them together on this list.
This challenge is officially on. We are down to 9 people in this challenge. I have your first item. And before I can even get to it, Christina is out.
Damn it.
Neither one ever won an individual challenge, and both of their tribes won less than 40% of the time. Number 11 is Sugar from Gabon and Heroes vs. Villains. Sugar's another person who never won an individual challenge, and she was stuck on the perpetually losing Fong tribe with Ken for most of the pre-merge. Number 10 is Scout from Vanuatu. Scout played in 12 individual challenges without ever winning one or even coming close, giving her the fourth worst individual war score ever recorded. Number 9 is Baylor from San Juan del Sur, whose tribes only won 2 challenges all season long. She did win 1 immunity challenge, though. Number 8 is Heather from Survivor 41. Heather's challenge stats at first didn't look that bad. Her tribe, Luvu, won 5 of its 7 challenges. Then I realized that Heather sat out for 4 of those wins, meaning her tribe was actually 1 for 3 when she was playing. Combine that with never winning a single post-merge challenge, and Heather ends up here on the list. Number 7 is Suri.
My mother always told me, you may not be able to beat him with these all the time, but you can always beat him with this.
And boy, can she not beat them with her muscles, as Suri, who has played in 27 individual challenges more than anyone else besides Parvati, has only won 1 individual challenge. Number 6 is Ryan from Heroes vs. Healers vs. Hustlers, who, like Scout, played in all 12 individual challenges on his season, lost all of them, and was on an even worse tribe. Number 5 is Stephanie from Palau, Guatemala, and Heroes vs. Villains. This really surprised me when I got into the rankings, since I had always assumed that Stephanie was a very good challenge competitor. At first, I thought maybe Stephanie had gotten screwed by being, like, the one good player on a bunch of bad tribes. After all, her teams have won only 9 out of 31 challenges. But in fact, her individual scores are even worse than her team scores. Though Stephanie has 5 near wins, she's only ever won 1 individual challenge across 3 seasons. And that puts her in the bottom 5 of Survivor Challenge competitors. Number 4 is Natalie White from Samoa. This one's pretty straightforward. Natalie's on Foa Foa, one of the worst performing tribes in Survivor history, and wins only 25% of her team's challenges. Then she makes the merge, where she wins no challenges for the rest of the season. And this is where we get some legendarily bad Survivor competitors. There's actually a bit of a tier gap between the people I've just named and this bottom 3. So let's start with number 3, Lydia from Guatemala. Lydia played in 10 team or tribe challenges and lost all but 2 of them. As an individual challenge competitor, she was even worse, losing all 11 challenges she played in without ever coming close. Number 2 is Crystal Cox from Gabon, a challenge competitor so legendarily bad that when, 2 years after Gabon, her Olympic gold medal was revoked after it came out that she had been using steroids, almost every Survivor viewer went, "Yeah, that makes sense." It was hard to believe that an Olympic athlete could be as bad at Survivor challenges as Crystal was, where she won 2 out of 12 team challenges and never won or even came close in 9 individual challenges. And number 1, the worst challenge competitor of all time, is Mookie from Fiji. And I honestly feel bad for the guy, because his individual challenge numbers are not great, but they're not as bad as Lydia or Crystal. While he never won an individual challenge, he only played in 3 of them. The real thing that drags his war score down is the single worst team score I have ever seen. Because Mookie was on Fiji's Ravu tribe, the Have-Nots, both pre- and post-swap, which means that Mookie played in 15 team challenges and won only 1. That gives him a team war score of -6.05. And again, in case you missed it earlier, the worst individual challenge performer of all time is Sandra, who has a -2.64 war score after losing all of the 21 individual immunity challenges she's ever played in. But because she's average on a team, she clocks in at number 557 out of 626 on this list. Not exactly high ranking, but not bad enough to be in this bottom group. Now it's time to talk about our top 40, the best Survivor Challenge competitors of all time. All of these players have adjusted war scores of 4 or higher, which means that almost all of these players were probably the best or second best challenge competitor on their season. Even making this list means you're a very strong challenge competitor, And who better to prove that point than number 40, Natalie Anderson, an Edge of Extinction returnee and the subject of multiple montages throughout Winners at War about her toughness. Between San Juan del Sur and Winners at War, Natalie won 7 out of 11 team challenges and won or came close in 7 out of 17 individual challenges. At number 39 is Fabio from Nicaragua, who basically wins the game because of how good he was at challenges. From the final 6 onward, Fabio goes on an immunity run. He is one of only 13 one-time players to make the top 40, a testament to his dominance on this season. Number 38 and number 37 is a tie between two winners, Nick and Tony, both competitors on Winners at War. It's an extremely weird coincidence, the only such tie between two players, made weirder by the fact that they have the same metrics in every category. Both won 12 out of 24 team-based challenges, both won 5 out of 20 individual challenges, and both even had 3 near wins each. Number 36 is where my inspiration for this video, Jonathan from Survivor 42, is going to land. Jonathan has a dominant 78% team win rate, and he was no slouch as an individual competitor. Though he only won 2 out of 10 individual challenges, he also recorded 5 near wins. And that's not even counting challenges like this, where he clearly gave up and started helping someone else. That means Jonathan was in it to win it for at least 70% of challenges. In a world where he won every challenge that he was close on, he would be the 7th best challenge competitor in Survivor history, and it would be the best single season benchmark in the show's history, up there with Colby and Ozzy. As it is, he's very good, but it'll take more data before we can call him elite. Speaking of people we need more data on, I'd like to introduce the only player in the top 40 to never even make the merge. At number 35, please welcome Marcus from Gabon. In addition to having a strategic stranglehold on the game before his ouster, Marcus was also on track to be perhaps the greatest challenge competitor in Survivor history, and I don't make that claim lightly. Marcus won more than 80% of the team challenges he competed in. Additionally, Gabon had a bunch of weird individual or one-on-one challenges in the pre-merge, and Marcus won 2 out of 3 of those. And the only one he lost? Well, that was the round where he went home. It was just the 2nd time the entire season that he was even eligible to be voted out. Marcus is the only person to post these kinds of numbers in such a short run, and for that reason, he's one of the greatest what-ifs on this list. Number 34 is Jervis from Borneo and Blood vs. Water. I was surprised to see Jervis on this list, but he's a well-balanced player, winning over 70% of team challenges, and winning or coming close in 5 out of 15 individual challenges. Right next to Jervis, at 33, is his ally, Aris, from Panama and Blood vs. Water. Aris is not quite as good as Jervis at team challenges, though still above average at 62%, but Aris is better at individual challenges. He's won 2 of 13 individual challenges, but more importantly, he has 6 near wins. Worth remembering that Aris was basically the only competition to Terry for most of Panama, and Terry is someone very high on this list. Number 32 is Parvati from Cook Islands, Fans vs. Favorites, Heroes vs. Villains, and Winners at War. Parvati holds the record for playing in the most individual challenges of any Survivor player, and that's where her stats shine. She's won 6 individual challenges with 2 more near wins. Number 31 is Tommy from Island of the Idols, perhaps the single most surprising person on this list for me personally. I don't remember Tommy being amazing at challenges, but the stats don't lie. Tommy won 2 individual challenges plus another 2 near wins, but he's particularly bolstered by an incredible 91% win rate in team-based challenges. Number 30 is Eric from Fans vs. Favorites and Karamoan. While Eric might be most famous for giving away immunity at the Final 5, it's worth remembering how Eric got that immunity in the first place. Specifically, he's extremely good at challenges. Eric won 5 out of 16 individual challenges. Also, here's a weird fact about Eric. He's the highest ranking person on this list to have 0 near wins. Basically, if Eric was remotely close to winning a challenge, he won it. If he didn't win it, he wasn't even close. I don't know what to make of that, if I'm being honest. It's just weird. Number 29 is Lex from Africa and All-Stars. Lex makes it this high despite having a below-average team war score. How? By being one of Survivor's original challenge beasts. Over his 2 seasons, Lex played in 13 individual challenges, won 5, and came close in another 3. Number 28 is Jenna Maraska from Amazon and All-Stars. Jenna's unlikely win in the Amazon was partially due to a surprising endgame challenge run, during which Jenna won 4 out of 12 individual challenges and nearly won a fifth. On top of that, Jenna's teams won 8 out of 11 challenges. And as a fun fact, all 3 times that Jenna was asked to sit out by her tribe, they lost the challenge. Clearly bad luck. Number 27 is Dominic from Ghost Island. Dom's teams won 8 out of 12 challenges, but as an individual, Dom won a third of the challenges he played in and nearly won another 2. Number 26 is Brad from Blood vs. Water and Game Changers. He won 10 out of 19 team-based challenges and then won 5 individual challenges of the 12 he played in. Number 25 is Brian, the winner of Survivor Thailand. Brian's tribe won exactly 50% of the challenges, just about average, but the Iceman dominated the individual challenge portion of the game, winning 5 out of 9 and nearly winning a 6th. The next 4 players have a lot in common. All 4 were from extremely dominant tribes, and these players were a vital part of that tribe's overall success, and then proceeded to be above average, though not quite dominant, at individual challenges. This group includes Burden from Pearl Islands at 24, Wendell from Ghost Island at 23.
Get Proust! What? I think I'm done, bro!
And Tom from Palau and Heroes vs. Villains at 21. Those 3 are incredible names that you would expect to see this high on a ranking of the best challenge competitors of all time. But sandwiched between them, at 22, is a name you almost certainly forgot about. Cole from Heroes vs. Healers vs. Hustlers. Mostly remembered as a lovable himbo on HHH, the reason I want to shine a spotlight on Cole is that, like Marcus from Gabon, Cole has one of the most insane stat lines I've ever seen, especially when you factor in that he only played once and finished 10th place on an 18-person season. Cole is the only person in Survivor history, and this is a true fact, who has a 100% win rate on teams. Pre-swap, post-swap, even randomly drawn reward challenge teams. If Cole was on the team, they won. It's that simple. Furthermore, Cole played on a 3-tribe season where only 3rd place ever had to go to tribal council, yet his tribe was still 1st place in 7 out of 10 challenges, often by substantial margins. In other words, Cole won 13 of the 15 challenges that were put before him during Survivor and never sat out at any point. Those are better stats than Ozzy, Joe, or even Boston Rob put up in their first seasons. Now, while I don't think Cole is very high on the list of potential returnees, there's a chance that if he came back, we would think about him in the same pantheon as those guys. And I think that's pretty remarkable. And that brings us to the top 20. Now, I would love to remind everyone once again, because the numbers can all blend together at a certain point and we forget what the baseline is, that again, an average Survivor wins just 1 out of 8 challenges they compete in, or about 12%, and the average near win percentage is even less, 10%, or just 1 in 10. I say this only so you can understand how crazy it is to win a 4th, a 3rd, even half of all the challenges one competes in. This is the elite competitor tier. Kicking off the top 20 is Spencer from Kagyan and Cambodia. Spencer's team war score is perfectly average, but between his 6 individual challenge wins and 5 near wins, he's the 11th best individual challenge competitor in Survivor history. Not bad for someone who started on one of the worst tribes of all time. Number 19 is someone who played with Spencer in Cambodia, Keith Nail. Keith became an unlikely fan favorite and challenge beast in San Juan del Sur and proved it wasn't a fluke in Cambodia. Keith is a well-balanced player, leading his teams to a 60% win rate while also winning 6 out of 25 individual challenges. And if 25 sounds high, it is. I still don't fully understand how this happened, but Keith has played in the 3rd most individual challenges of any Survivor, right behind Parvati and Suri. Number 18 is JT from Tokenshin's Heroes vs. Villains and Game Changers. Living proof that the sequel will never be as good as the original, JT has led his teams to a 57% win rate while winning or nearly winning 6 of the 11 individual challenges he's competed in. Number 17 is Bob, the winner of Survivor Gabon, the season of statistical flukes. When Marcus was eliminated early and two of his fellow competitors were on track to be the worst challenge competitors in Survivor history, someone had to step up as the new challenge beast. But no one expected it to be the oldest man out there. Yet the 57-year-old physics teacher put up one of the most impressive single-season challenge runs in the show's history, leading his teams to a 67% win rate while also winning another 5 out of 11 individual challenges. Number 16 is Ian from Palau. Ian, like Tom earlier on this list, was on the Karor tribe, the only tribe to win so many pre-merge challenges that there was never a merge. The only player left on the other tribe, Stephanie, was simply absorbed into their tribe. While this was generally good for Karor player statistics, it also means that Ian has the weird distinction of having more sit-outs than any other player in the top 20, because of situations like this.
Alright, Karor. Greg, Karen, and Katie participated in the reward. You guys are sitting this out along with two other people. Who are the two other sit-outs?
I'm sitting out.
Tom and Ian are also sitting out.
Ian, one of the strongest members of the Karor tribe, sat out 5 times and watched his tribe win 4 of those challenges. Because of that, his team stats are actually slightly less impressive when you account for sit-outs. Still, he won 70% of the team challenges he competed in and then dominated the individual portion of the game. Even surrounded by strong competitors like Tom and Greg, Ian won 4 of Palau's 10 individual challenges and nearly won 4 more, which means Ian won or nearly won 80% of the individual challenges. Put another way, Ian dominated his fellow Karor tribe mates even more than he dominated the Oolong tribe. It's only fitting, then, that Ian's game ended not by losing a challenge, but by giving up on the challenge and asking to be voted out. He was the only person who could beat himself.
I'll go now and take Katie. And I'll give up the million to get back your guys' friendship.
Number 15 is Rupert from Pearl Islands, All-Stars, Heroes vs. Villains, and Blood vs. Water. The only player to be given $1 million by America for simply being their favorite, Rupert's strength in challenges is sometimes overlooked in favor of his other qualities. Maybe this is because Rupert's individual win rate is not eye-popping. Winning 3 out of 19 individual challenges, or 16%, may seem underwhelming. It's not that much higher than the 12% baseline average. But Rupert has more near wins than any other player, coming in second in 8 of the 16 challenges he lost. I swear, number 14 is not a joke or a mistake. It's Boo from Fiji. And if you're asking, who is Boo? That's a great question, and one that I had to figure out for myself. Boo is buoyed to 14 by 2 major factors. First, he was a member both pre- and post-swap of the Moto Haves tribe, which means he has a team win rate of over 80%. He's basically the mirror image of Mookie being number 1 on the worst challenge competitors of all time. Second, he won or nearly won 5 of the 8 individual challenges he competed in that season, so he was still very good on his own merits. Number 13 is Chrissy from Heroes vs. Healers vs. Hustlers. Though Chrissy's personality ultimately rubbed the jury the wrong way, her challenge prowess was unrivaled on her season, particularly following Cole's elimination from the game. Chrissy wins her first individual challenge in the first episode after Cole's vote out, and proceeds to win 5 of the remaining 6 challenges after that. It's one of the most impressive challenge runs in the show's history, and if not for a last-minute twist that brought her nemesis Ben to the final 3, it's possible she might have won the whole game. Number 12 is Matt from Redemption Island. If Marcus was the only person to make the top 40 without making the merge, Matt might be the only player to make the top 40 without ever winning a team challenge. Known primarily for his devout Christian faith, Matt was blindsided at only his 2nd tribal council and was sent to Redemption Island, where he dueled his way back into the game for the merge, only to be voted out immediately, forcing him to duel his way back all the way to the finale, where he came up just 1 win short of re-entering the game at the final 5. Matt ultimately won 7 of the 11 individual duels and got 2nd place in another 3. In fact, Matt only lost 2 individual challenges the whole season, the merge challenge where he was voted off, and the final duel to re-enter the game. Now that's bad luck. Thus, despite his dismal team score, Matt has the 4th best individual war score in the show's history. Number 11 is Michelle from Ko Rong and Winners at War. Michelle doesn't fit the mold of a traditional Survivor Challenge beast. She was even pitied by her tribe mates in Ko Rong as a challenge liability early on. but she is perhaps one of the most clutch competitors in Survivor history when her back is against the wall. Michelle's teams have won 60% of challenges, and Michelle herself has won 7 out of 22 individual challenges, and nearly won another 2. At number 10 on the list is Tyson from Token Chains, Heroes vs. Villains, Blood vs. Water, and Winners at War. Tyson has been called one of the most fearsome competitors in Survivor history by some of his fellow players, and it's no secret why. In addition to his incredible 64% team win rate, Tyson has won 5 out of 17 individual challenges and nearly won another 2, including winning his way back from the edge of extinction in Winners at War. Number 9 is Mike, the winner of Survivor Worlds Apart. Put simply, Mike's run on Worlds Apart is the most dominant performance by any one-time Survivor player, statistically speaking. He wins 8 out of 12 team challenges, wins 6 out of 11 individual challenges, and nearly wins 2 more individual challenges. And though they're not calculated into this formula, it's worth noting that Mike's tallies in the loss column don't tell the full story. He throws the final challenge of the pre-merge to keep his ally Kelly safe, and even hacks challenge-replacing events like the Survivor Auction to try and get a competitive advantage. Mike wins this season off the back of his hustle and utter challenge dominance, and it's not hard to see why. Number 8 is Kim from One World and Winners at War. In addition to her incredible strategic and social play, Kim is one of the strongest female challenge competitors in the show's history. Kim's teams have won 58% of challenges, while as an individual, Kim has won 6 of the 18 challenges she's played in, and nearly won another 5. Number 7 is Colby from the Australian Outback, All-Stars, and Heroes vs. Villains. The OG Survivor Challenge beast, Colby's Season 2 performance is legendary. It's so legendary, in fact, that his dismal performance in Season 20 isn't enough to knock him out of the all-time top 10. Colby has played in 34 challenges during his Survivor career, winning 18 of those and only sitting out twice. He's won 8 of 21 individual challenges and nearly won another 2. Poetically, one of those near wins came in his very last challenge ever, at the final 5 of Heroes vs. Villains. Number 6 will probably surprise people, but it shouldn't. It's Andrea from Redemption Island, Karamoan, and Game Changers. Often one of the best parts of bad seasons, Andrea boasts the single best team war score in the show's history. Andrea's teams almost never lose. She has played in 32 team challenges and won 24 of them, for a win rate of 75% across 3 seasons. And lest you think she's being carried by tribe swap luck, she's only sat out 1 challenge during that entire run. It's a huge part of the reason Andrea always makes the merge. And her individual challenge skill is why she always gets targeted around mid to late jury. She has won or nearly won 8 of the 22 individual challenges she's competed in, including beating number 12 on this list, Matt, to win her way back in from Redemption Island. But Andrea's not statistically the best female competitor of all time. That honor goes to number 5, Laura Moret from Samoa and Blood vs. Water. As one of the leaders of the Galu tribe in Samoa, Laura's team win rate is an extraordinary 85%. But her individual war score is even better. Thanks to her run on Redemption Island in Blood vs. Water, Laura has won 7 out of 14 individual challenges and nearly won an 8th. Number 4 is Terry Dietz from Panama and Cambodia. There's a very good case to be made that Terry's Panama game, where 75% of his stats come from thanks to his early exit in Cambodia, is the most impressive one-season challenge performance in Survivor history. Terry has won 12 out of 20 team challenges, but he shines individually. Of the 12 individual challenges he's competed in, Terry has won 8 of them, and nearly won a 9th. And yet, Terry's not the best competitor in Survivor history. In fact, he's not even in the top 3. There's actually a fairly significant tier break, statistically, between Terry and number 3. This comes from a few factors. For one, all 3 of the remaining men have played on at least 3 seasons, so there's a lot more statistical data for the model to be confident in ranking them so highly. For another, these guys are just that good. In fact, they're the 3 people I bet you immediately thought about when you clicked on this video. The 3 who have legitimate cases for being the greatest of all time at a certain category of Survivor. So let's dive in. At number 3, Boston Rob. Boston Rob has played on 5 seasons, more than any other player, and is among the top 5 players in most challenges played all time. Though Rob's first season was marked by his tribe's inability to win challenges, he has turned that reputation around. Over the years, Rob's reputation has grown as perhaps the greatest of all time when it comes to puzzles, a fact that helps him in both team and individual challenges. Rob has won 10 individual challenges and nearly won another 4. At 35 overall wins, he has the second most challenge wins in Survivor history. He's won more than half of the challenges he's competed in. Number 2 is Joe, from Worlds Apart, Cambodia, and Edge of Extinction. Joe is one of the later additions to the Survivor family, but he made a quick impression with back-to-back Challenge Beast stints in seasons 30 and 31. At one point, Joe looked like he could legitimately comp out for the entirety of Cambodia and literally collapsed from exhaustion mid-challenge because he refused to quit. He was somehow even better in 38, where he won all but one Premier's Challenge, a reward challenge, and powered his teams to first place in every single challenge, despite 3 tribes competing. When he lost the very first individual challenge he played in 38, his own tribe mates believed they might never get the chance to vote him out again and turned on him immediately. And they had good reason. Joe has won half of all the individual challenges he's ever competed in, winning 7 out of 14, and nearly won another 3. He's roughly equal to Terry as an individual competitor, yet by contrast to everyone else in the top 5, Joe's true strength comes from the team challenges, not the individual portion. In team challenges, he's borderline unstoppable, winning 74% of all challenges and nearly tying Andrea for the best team war score of all time. So here we are, number 1. It's Ozzy. And deep down, you knew it was going to be Ozzy all along. Somehow, I think I knew it too. I knew it would be either Ozzy or Joe on top when I started making this video. But here's what I didn't know. Ozzy is number 1, and it's not even close. Look at this chart. This is Mookie, the worst Survivor competitor of all time. This is your average Survivor competitor, your coaches of the world. This is Natalie Anderson, number 40 on our list today. That's her war score. This is Spencer, number 20 on our list today. This is the full top 10. This is Rob. This is Joe. And this is Ozzy. The gap between Ozzy and Joe is bigger than the gap between Joe and Spencer. It's bigger than the gap between Spencer at number 20 and Coach at number 247. It's even bigger than the gap between Ceree at 620 and Jeremy Collins at number 74. Think about how much better Jeremy is than Ceree at challenges. And that's how much of a gap there is between Ozzy and Joe in second place. He is the Wayne Gretzky or the Tom Brady of Survivor challenges. You could split Ozzy into 2 different people, and both of him would be in the top 5 all time. He is a beautiful anomaly, a challenge beast without peer or equal. And what makes him so good is that, much like the sports stars I've just mentioned, there's a bit of a secret sauce here, and it's volume. Ozzy doesn't have a season like Cole where he wins 100% of challenges. But Ozzy has played in 6 times more challenges than that man, and the more challenges you play, the more confident the model feels with assessing your quality as a player. Cole having a good season could be a fluke. Crystal Cox having a bad season could be a fluke. Maybe if they came back for round 2, they'd regress back to the mean. Ozzy has played 4 seasons, and he has never regressed back to the mean. All he's done is proven over and over and over again that he really is that good, and that gives him a huge boost. Ozzy has played in 47 team challenges and won 29 of them, good for a rate of 62%. He has never sat out once. Of the top 10, only he, Joe, and Kim have never once sat out of a challenge. Ozzy is extremely good at team challenges, the 3rd best of all time after Andrea and Joe, but Ozzy is unparalleled at individual challenges. Ozzy wins 61% of individual challenges he plays in. He's played in 23 challenges, won 14, and of the 9 he lost, he nearly won another 3. On bulk alone, he's won more challenges than anyone else in Survivor history, and it's not very close. At number 3 all-time is Joe, who's won 30. At number 2 all-time is Rob, who's won 35. Ozzy has 43. Joe and Rob could both come back and play another season, and unless they reach finale night, they still wouldn't top that number. And now that Survivor is moving into a new era and emphasizing its younger players, it's very possible that no one ever will. So that's it then. Ozzy is the best challenge competitor in Survivor history, and it's not even close. Remember, if you want the full rankings of all 626 players, check out the Google Drive spreadsheet in the links. The players are color-coded to denote the amount of data I have on them. Players in white have a statistically insignificant pool of data to draw conclusions from, so I didn't rank them here today, while players in gray have sufficient data, and players in gold have abundant data that makes me fairly confident in the rankings. Let me know if there's any other weird projects or questions you would love to see me address next, and thanks for watching this absurdly long video. I'm glad you enjoyed yourself.